This query shows information about what a customer ordered and paid, when it was, how much it was, and so on. What if you want to see when a customer last had activity? Either when did they last place an order, or when did they last make a payment? Hi, this is Crystal. Max date order and max date pay can be compared, and the latest one can be returned. What if one of them is not filled, such as for Roger Allen, who placed an order but has not yet made a payment? Or for Greg Granger, who made a payment of $500 on an order that is not yet in the system? We can write a function to return the maximum value. Internally, dates are numbers. Press Alt F11 to go to the Visual Basic Editor, which is called the VBE, where you will find VBA. Before we start writing code, let's sidestep into dates and how they are handled. Press Ctrl G to go to the Debug window. This is also called the Immediate window, since you can get immediate answers. Let's ask some questions. Type ?date and press Enter. This tells us the current date. What is the date and time? Use the Now function. ?now and press Enter. Now let's convert that into a number. ?cdbl, open parenthesis, now, close parenthesis, and press Enter. The whole part of the number is the days that have passed since zero. The fractional part of the number corresponds to the time of day. Noon is 0.5 since it's halfway through the day. The time for me, as I am recording this, is 1:29 p.m. Since there are 24 hours in a day, multiply the fractional part by 24. This results in almost 13 and a half. Since 1 p.m. is after noon, 12 is added to make 13. The fractional hours can be turned into minutes by multiplying by 60. Some seconds have passed since starting these questions, but the hour is right, and so is the minute. When was 1? ?cdate, open parenthesis 1, close parenthesis. When was 0? 12 o'clock a.m. is actually not too helpful. Let's try that another way. Format 0 to be a date, so use the format function on 0 and give it a format code. We see that 1 is December 31st, 1899. Now that we have an understanding that dates are numbers, let's close the debug window and write a new function. From the menu, choose Insert Module. By default, you will see Option Compare Database at the top. This tells Access to compare uppercase and lowercase to match. So if you type lowercase a, then capital A will match. Option Explicit automatically appearing happens because I changed defaults under Tools Options. I set Require Variable Declaration to true by checking the box. I also set the tab width to 3 instead of 4. That means when tab is pressed, 3 spaces will be added. Indenting code helps understanding. Extra spaces and blank lines don't matter to the code, but it makes it easier for a human to read. The first step is deciding if this will be a function or a sub. Since this will return a value, it will be a function. Then a space, and then the name. Names can be much longer than you should make them. Try and think of something concise and easy to remember. I like to start many functions with get. Max is short for maximum, so we will call this get max, with a capital G and a capital M. Rather than limiting the function to dates or a specific data type, We can use the variant data type, so any simple data type can be used. Next comes a parenthesis to start the parameters. Space underscore at the end of a line means the statement is continued on the next line. I like to see everything without having to scroll horizontally and to separate the meaningful parts, so I continue statements a lot. The arguments can be blank if you don't want to send any information. In this case, we want to compare two numbers. Name these variables something that makes sense. They are passed, so let's start with a little p. The data type will be variant, so v comes next. This will be a number, and this is the first one, 1. The next parameter is the second number. These will both be variants. That is all the parameters, so type a close parenthesis. The return value will also be a variant data type, since we don't know what the actual data type will be. And it could be different for different cases. We have the function declaration and the statement signaling the end. What we want to happen will be in between. First, I like to make a comment about when this is being written and by who. Comments start with a single quote mark. Then I like to make a comment about what the function does and the parameters it needs. It's a good idea to specify what the default value will be in case the function cannot be calculated. Variants can be null, so the return value will be initialized to null. Null actually means no value. If the first parameter is null, then see if the second parameter has a value. If the second parameter is not null, that will be the return value for the function. If there is no value for either argument, then nothing more can be done, so exit. If the first parameter does have a value, but the second one does not, then the result will be the first parameter. Names. Actually, value is better than number, since it is more generic. This code will actually work with strings, too, although I don't see a useful purpose for that right now. Change all occurrences of PV number to PV value for this procedure. When you press Ctrl H, if you have anything selected, it will go into the find box. If both of the parameters have values, then compare them. If the first one is greater than or equal to the second, then the first parameter will be the result. Otherwise, send back the second one. When you name a module, make it different than any other module name or procedure name. Ooh, I forgot to copy the name of the function. Let me cancel naming and do that first. Now save and name with the prefix. I'm using mod underscore, then the function name. A module can have several procedures, but if you do that, it's good if they're grouped by functionality. Since this doesn't relate to anything else we've written, it will go in its own module. Copy its name and then save again. Include the name and make sure the module name is different. When you debug compile, if there were any errors, the compiler will stop on that statement. To demonstrate, I'll misspell a variable name in the code. Because option explicit is set at the top, variable names are checked. Access tells me something is wrong. I see it and fix it, then debug compile again. All is good. Save. Now, let's try it. The QCustomerBalance query has two dates. Which one is most recent? Make a new calculated column using this expression. Last activity, colon, get max, open parenthesis, max date order, comma, max date pay, close parenthesis. As much as possible, it is good to copy and paste. This helps alleviate misspellings. As you can see, for each record, Access has correctly identified the last date. If neither the order or the last payment date has a date, there's no error message either. Simply, nothing is listed. Close and save this query. Complement the many built-in functions such as absolute value, converting to a date, getting file information, formatting, and parsing strings by writing your own custom functions. What you write is user-defined function, or UDF. If you can create a complex expression, then you also have the logic to create a custom function. Like this video and pass it along to your friends, and subscribe to this channel. Through sharing, we will all get better.